it's like 45 minutes like average commute to, for you. Right now I am like in the
thank you. respectful. Oh, Ariel, you brought the whole thing.
And he already knows our viewpoint.
We'll be starting momentarily, so if you can take your seats, that would be terrific. Thanks so much. Good morning. Thank you. Welcome to She Sails, Mava Hall, Inspiring Women 2023. I'm so very grateful to be here together with you in community. I had hoped we would start She Sails in a mindset of unmitigated joy, but our community suffered a huge loss this week with the sudden death of French teacher Chris Johnson. Chris taught at Mava Hall for 23 years, and his family is part of our on-campus community. Chris's absence today is a reminder of how irreplaceable each one of us is, and how much we should value every moment that we have together. In honor of Chris and his joyful spirit, we will not have a moment of silence. Instead, and listen carefully as I'm going to give you some instructions to do right now that involves talking with your table mates. I hope you will think about someone who is dear to you and what it is that you value about them, and share that with your table mates. Or you can engage in one of Chris's favorite activities, telling really bad dad jokes. And of course, if you knew Chris and want to share a memory of him with your table mates, you may do so. This feels much more in keeping with Chris's exuberant sense of conversation and humor.
Took on the important task of leading our school into the 21st century. To do that,
she knew that we needed to make a significant upgrade for athletic facilities and move beyond the simplicity of Mudd Gymnasium to this amazing multi-purpose Shipley Center for Athletics, Health, and Wellness. The Ship, as it is known today, is a world-class facility that has transformed our entire educational program and exponentially raised the level of our athletics, health, and wellness profile. This building has changed our community in ways I am not sure that even Blair could have imagined. By providing this wonderful space for us to gather and learn and celebrate together. Quite simply, we could not have dreamed of having something like She Sails without a building like this. Now, of course, the Dana Hall experience is rooted in people and relationships. But having spaces that support those relationships is crucial. The leaders who came before me knew this, and I am proud to carry forward their legacy of turning aspirations into action. If this is your first day back on campus in some time, you may be discovering spaces that are brand new to you, or perhaps be visiting spaces that are familiar but have a different look or use. And you have likely taken note, or soon will, of a very large construction project that's happening across the pond. We are very excited about our upper school classroom building project. The new space will meet the needs of generations of Dana Hall students, with flexible classrooms that support diverse learning styles, common spaces that foster connection and collaboration, brand new art studios, a purpose-built chorus room, and fully accessible facilities. At the same time, it will honor our history and rich tradition of academic excellence. This has been a priority since the very beginning of our design process, when we made the decision to preserve the shell of the building rather than tear it down. We want all of you to recognize the school you attended when you return for future reunions and She Sails events. Today we are honored to be joined by members of the class of 1958 who are they're here celebrating their 65th reunion, and they are an amazing group of women. I have been honored to spend time with them and to learn from them. And one thing that is particularly fascinating about this group is that they were among the first students to learn inside the classroom building when it opened in 1956. In fact, many of them remember carrying books into the new building, and there's this amazing photograph up in the archives that captures that milestone of our school. So if you are up in the archives looking for the line of girls carrying books into the new classroom building. This transformative project is for them as much as it is for the future of our school, because it ensures that the school's learning spaces reflect and embody the vigorous education that has been at the center of Dana Hall's timeless mission for over 140 years. This is an inspiring and exciting time for Dana Hall School, not just for the future that lies ahead, but because of the strength of our foundation and because of the learning and growth that is happening here every day, right now. I hope that you, students and families, faculty and staff, and alumni from across the generations, are inspired, as I am, by the energy of this campus and the abundant possibilities of our audacious dreams. I'm relying on you as we grow our legacy of leadership, innovation, and impact. Together, we will take the lessons learned at She Sails, which call upon us to be bold and dream big, and we'll embrace those aspirations with determination and conviction. Thank you very much. I'd like to now introduce our all-school co-president, Sophia Sani and Rhea Sharma, to introduce our speakers.
And we are this year's All School Co-Presidents. We are excited to be here today, and we are honored to introduce and welcome the 2023 She Sails keynote speaker.
Margaret Bowles Fitzgerald, class of 1973, is the Emeritus Chair of the Board at the Henry Luce Foundation, which distributes more than $44 million annually in the area's of Higher Education, East and Southeast Asia, Theology, Public Policy, International Relations, American Art, and through the Claire Booth Program, advancing women in the fields of math, science, and engineering. Ms. Fitzgerald serves on the board of directors at the Brookline Bank and WBUR, Boston's NPR station, and the Roy T. Morgan Foundation in Rhode Island. She's also the chair of the American Art Committee and at the Harvard Arts Museum. She's a past trustee at the Boston Ballet, Big Brothers Association of Greater Boston, and Associated Grantmakers.
For 24 of 30 years, Ms. Fitzgerald was the Director of Corporate Community Relations at Hill Holiday Advertising, serving in prior roles there as a media planner, a public relations manager, and corporate philanthropy chief of staff to the president and CEO. During her tenure, she created and managed the Department of Corporate Community Relations, rising to the rank of executive vice president, defining and implementing the company's ongoing commitment and service to the nonprofit sector in Boston and the nation. She previously worked as the Director of Corporate and Foundation Relations at the Boston Healthcare for the Homeless Program, and as Executive Vice President and Director of Alumni Communications and Stewardship at Emmanuel College. She is currently a communications consultant for Boston Healthcare for the Homeless, and she's a communications and freelance writing consultant in both the nonprofit and for-profit sector. She focuses on effective communications, public messaging, board governance, and risk management.
Ms. Fitzgerald is a former member of the Dana Hall Board of Trustees, and is also the mother of a Dana Hall graduate. Her daughter, Molly, graduated in 2004. In 2008, Ms. Fitzgerald was honored as Dana Hall's Distinguished Alumna. She's a proud member of the class of 1973, who are here celebrating their 50th reunion this weekend. We are so happy they are here to support their classmate. Please welcome Margaret Bowles Fitzgerald.
Humanity. I hope many of you were able to hear her yesterday. Thanks Thanks also to Kathy Luby, almost 23 years on this campus, serving Dana Hall with creative and inclusive events such as this. On a deeply personal level, she has been endlessly encouraging of me in my career and my life. Kathy, you are very special to me. And finally, in my warm-ups and thanks of praise this morning, congratulations to the senior class. Perhaps no cohort in the school's history has been faced with such a steady stream of disruptions amidst the studies, driven partly as a result of the school's campus master plan and partly by outside forces beyond anybody's control. Class of 23, I've been told you have done so with equal measures of understanding, acceptance, and humor. Four formative years of peregrinations around this campus, not to mention the endless streams on the screens of virtual learning. And now about to graduate. Strong, well-educated, perhaps even better educated because of the very disruptions faced and the flexibility asked of you. That you've made it this far speaks to your muscular fortitude and your great inner resolve. Resilience, bravo. So I've been asked to launch this grand vessel known as She Sails with some words of encouragement and inspiration, a message that might be both universal and personal, directional and prescriptive, grounding and seaworthy, philosophical and academic. That's all. But this is, after all, where academics, formal and informal education, really are its organizing principle and motivating force, its reason for being. But to speak primarily to an audience of young women, to navigate some thoughts, a message that plunges into the frothy waters in the life and times of the adolescent girl and young woman can be challenging. For my education, your education, my willingness, your willingness to learn, your capacity and my capacity to learn is deeply individualistic. It's a process that's deeply personal. In theory and practice, our educational journeys must be thoughtfully crafted and dispensed. There will be many messengers. Learning will come more easily for some than others. Growth of any kind happens at different speeds. That's what makes each one of us unique, and our education and evolution, and our own education a distinct personal revolution. What we are offered at Dana Hall are the pedagogical building blocks to what will always be part of lifelong learning. Material education happens here. Continuing education comes in the years that follow. But oh, the agony, even the drudgery of what we must study in those formative years. Not long ago, I caught a quote from a British comedian who said this, it made me laugh. Education must have been so much easier during Shakespeare's time because you didn't have to study Shakespeare. That was pretty good. Oh yes, all those obscure metaphors, nasty villains, hellish wagers, star-crossed lovers, puckish ends, hallway ghosts, and so much swordplay. So that got me thinking, what I'd have given to predate the likes of Archimedes or Euclid, mathematics, geography, still an imponderable morass to me. I would have been happy to live before they started messing with our minds, measuring vortexes or crafting numerical equations and negative numbers. Closer to our times, I would have fared much better in the sciences had I been born before Madame Curie. None of that stuff about physics or chemistry, nothing to do with the hazardous testing of radiation. Turns out it was dangerous to her health after all, and to my sanity. But learn I did, and as all of you did and do. There's no way around it. You should not want to get around it. The old maxim is true. If you think education is costly, try ignorance. A full curriculum, a broad knowledge base, even in those subjects you abhor, are foundational to navigating the waters and the obscure and seemingly endless horizon in front of you today and tomorrow. The navigating of life into who you will become and how hopefully you will like who you become. It's tempting to rail against the speed with which the world turns and change happens in these our times, tempting as always to default to the parochial concept that no one before us had so many changes. But for a bit of historical context about time and change, I decided to do a little time travel with my family ancestors, their vintage years, if you will, many with blessedly long lives. Here's what I've learned about them and their times. My great-grandparents, both sides of my family, were born, more or less, about 140 years ago, the early 1880s, coincidentally the same time that Henry Durant and his equally dedicated activist wife, Pauline, did you know he took her name? His name was Henry Fowles. He took on her name. So Henry and Pauline Durant, let's not forget about Pauline, founded Dana Hall, and my ancestors, 201, they moved around mostly on their own steam. That is, on their legs or by the complementary devices known as horse and carriage, maybe a bicycle here or there. They were born 20 years before the first gasoline-powered car was road tested by the Duryea brothers of Springfield, Massachusetts in 1893. And they were born about 30 years before the first subway rattled down the tracks in the United States in Boston in 1897. Politically, their lives spanned the presidencies of Ulysses S. Grant to John F. Kennedy. Militarily, they had as the war roll call, the Battle of Little Bighorn, Wounded Knee, the Spanish-American War, World War I, World War II, Korea, and they were the first to witness the first Marines sent to South Vietnam. They were 10 years old when Thomas Edison formed the Edison Electric Illuminating Company, but it wasn't until they were in their 50s that most homes in the United States had electricity. They were in their 30s when the Wright brothers took to the skies in the Kitty Hawk Flyer in North Carolina, but they were in their 70s when the British de Havilland Comet made the first commercial jet flight from London to Johannesburg. During their lifetime, the nation went from horse and carriage to automobiles, from Jim Crow to civil rights, from twice daily newspapers to network television news. The women were refused entry to college because they were women. Despite rigorous academic studies from childhood to adolescence into adulthood, those same two women, my great-grandmothers, were in their mid-40s before the 19th Amendment was ratified, finally giving them the right to vote. Yet their daughters, my grandmothers and great-aunts, born in the early 1900s, all graduated from college, two of them from Wellesley College, and were eligible to vote at their 21st birthday. What's the moral of my family history, which has perhaps lived out like some of your ancestors? Well, there's much change and much accomplishment in a person and a family's and an institution and in a country's lifetime. But it is only in hindsight that we see how the wheels of what we call progress move with deliberate intention and innovation in order to ready up to take great leaps forward. For progress to happen at all, learning, a comprehensive education, is necessary to participate in the innovation to make progress possible. With this learning, this new knowledge, comes a responsibility, I feel, for very active civic engagement, the necessity of taking in knowledge while also taking up principles, petitions, positions, pens, posters, and to be part of the next change that is waiting to happen. These days, there's much talk and plenty of significant studies in the academy and beyond about the relentless barrage of information that comes to us from every possible angle or source, sought or not, about the ways and the speed with which the world is changing, and presumably us with it, with a particularly keen focus on the tools of technology that offer an easy entry, but sneakily and seductively, like that proverbial Crawford apple, drive a hard bargain and demand a high emotional price for our attention, our precious time, and how we parse it. With the real and pseudosciences that are both instructive and cautionary, we are urged to find ourselves, know ourselves, and feel we must offer ourselves to some precious sacrifice on the altar of life. self-enlightenment, self-awareness. The shelves of stores and libraries groan with self-help books. Ashrams and boot camps guide you to your inner better being. The sanctuaries in houses of worship are less full, but conference rooms and stadiums abound with tub thumping from self-anointed self-help gurus. Heaven help us all. You would think these are all New Age revelations, when actually, and here I go again with a bit of time travel, this kind of reflection with wisdom following was out there waiting for us. Go back to the Temple of Apollo, circa 20th century BC. Folks, that's 40 centuries ago. And you will find three welcome maxims carved into the stones over the door, including this one, know thyself. Actually, there are 147 other maxims to go along with the headlining three in Delphi, and all of them endure as remarkably timeless, geographically agnostic, and spiritually ecumenical. Everything in moderation. Be yourself. Respect your parents. Give back what you have received. Help your friends. Pursue honor. Love friendship. Cling to discipline. Praise virtue. Practice what is just, etc. 147 of those. Do they sound familiar? Good ideas, all of those ageless and universal proverbs, those rules to live by that guide your own character formation and your engagement in life with family, friends, teachers, and other citizens of planet Earth. Those pithy pearls of wisdom had a way of staying out there through the centuries and sticking to our present-day hunches, our intrinsic instincts, our own internal moral compasses. Of course, the search for knowledge is a timeless enterprise, a worthwhile pursuit in exploration that first turns inward and then, as importantly, pivots outward to those with whom we seek company and counsel, who often can be one and the same. Its importance has been lauded by many throughout history from many lands, including Pythagoras, Lao Tzu, and Benjamin Franklin. Certainly, self-knowledge, the truth about who we are, is important. Let's not sell it short. But the problem, the challenge always is how we manifest the truth we discover about ourselves, how we become what we know we should or hope to become. If we're fortunate, we've had many teachers, old and new, to guide us on the journey, along with a million life experiences to bump, bruise, and boost us along. Self-examination is an ongoing process, but I think it's less about finding yourself and more about creating yourself. And I hope you find this an exciting newsflash. You're never done. But the pursuit should free all of you, all of us, from what I've noticed today is the relentless tyranny of perfection. The unavailable, unassailable pinnacle of perfection. And by the way, who gets to decide what perfection is, right? Who decided back then and now? Ancient civilizations tried to name it and claim it. They then went so far as to capture perfection in precise drawings, on vases, or in three-dimensional sculpture. Propaganda then. I call them vase book postings. The fickle gold standard, very fickle gold standard, instead of the moderating golden mean. Golden mean goes back to Delphi as well. So where are those models now? Where are those warriors, demigods, athletes, models, besides being flattened in the pages of books or frozen in marble? And accessorized with what? A rock? A spear? A fawn? A dame? A discreet fig leaf or robe? Collecting dust and for brief moments our fleeting attention. Instead, it's our very imperfections, our flaws, our mistakes, our wrong answers in multiple choice exams, poor jokes and verbal gaffes, socially awkward miscues, our things done and left undone, for which we hope for forgiveness by others, what we either share in all humility or what we hide in chagrin or embarrassment. All these happenings are what we should gently bundle into our naturally imperfect human condition and our personal databases of experience. In fact, if it weren't for our imperfections, if we were not provided for the knack of being wrong, we would never get anything useful done. What a concept. It's trial and error. It's not trial and triumph. It's not trial and rightness. We think our way along to better, best, by testing and then choosing between right and wrong alternatives. Contention lies in as part of the crucible of creation. The wrong choices are to be made in tandem with the balancing partner, the right ones, and then progress. We get along in life this way. Did you know that we were actually coded for error, biologically coded for error? This is not a binary dance. It's not go, no go. Instead, it's go, no go, maybe, and let's give it a try. In all this constructive contention, you're going to land somewhere. And no matter what the final right answer, you'll have learned much from it in the process of getting to it. Today, we've become not so much self-aware as self-conscious. And then we hold ourselves back by fear of failing. Our doubts are our traitors, impeding our capacity to try, no matter what the outcome. All the while, we have this sneaking suspicion that there's something alive inside of us, something really vital inside of us, actually running the joint. Who we are, who we will become, who we are meant to become, that is perfectly imperfect. And at the same time, we come to know that we're also vitally connected and mutually dependent upon others and their perfect imperfections. All you need to do is study nature, or those who study nature, and see that everything and everyone in a million different ways hitches a ride with something or someone else. Our limitations, our imperfections, are made perfect in this kind of hitchhiking. Do me, do yourself, do your parents a favor and stop judging yourself so harshly. Please stop comparing yourself against yourself so unfairly and alongside others so inaccurately. I remember what a wonderful great uncle told me decades ago as I verbally picked away at my appearance and thus more insidiously at my self-confidence. He cautioned me, do not point out what you think your flaws are. You've dissected yourself with the precision of a surgeon. Chances are, no one has noticed them, but once you share them, that's all they'll notice. And that is how you will think of yourself. You will have reduced yourself to a puddle of imperfections. Along those lines, and in a much more public living room, I'm reminded over and over again by my modern-day oracle, Eleanor Roosevelt, who said, "You shouldn't worry so much about what others think of you, if you realized how little they do think about you." On the other side of the existential coin, please do not look at others who hold themselves up on those false altars of Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, and the like as your aspirational paragons. I would ask you to put down your mirrors and other handheld devices, close down the dispiriting dirge of streaming videos and shaming ads, a pas de deux between you and your false dance partner, the screen. Silence your sabotaging inner dialogue, and instead, with an outward gaze, tackle the implausible or the seemingly impossible, the fascinating, the infuriating, with a personal resolve to believe in yourself and your ability to give good learning a whirl. When necessary, which will be often, channel your inner Eleanor Roosevelt, who said you must do the thing you think cannot do. Take on challenges, pleasures, and genuine curiosities that expand the mind, not allowing indifference or ignorance. Worst of all, quiet defeat or retreat be your default setting, plunging into the endless feedback loop of group thinking and what I call self-shrinking. How dull, how dismissive of your wonderful uniqueness, imperfections, and all. So now I go back in time again to Shakespeare, and visit two of his plays, part of his comedic repertoire. And for a moment, please forget the gender politics of Elizabethan era, which Shakespeare was scribbling away, in which men played all roles, male, female, spirits, ghosts, witches, and even an occasional donkey. I summon up two clever, caring, smart, perceptive young women among the cast of characters, and in each case, the only, or surely the central woman in the cast of characters. Miranda from The Tempest and Viola from Twelfth Night. Why those two for She Sails? Because each one of them found themselves traveling across vast oceans, with clearly incompetent men at the helm and some nasty weather patterns afoot, and they ended up being shipwrecked. They were forced to survive by their own wits, physical and intellectual ingenuity. Both were able to find their way to the shores of remote islands, foreign settings filled with, you got it, only men. No wonder Viola said, after surveying her odds of a pleasant life on the rocky promontory, I wish to be westward ho. But don't you worry about their fates. Turns out Shakespeare wasn't going to easily dispatch them, make them bit players. Turns out he had work to do and morals to tell through them. First impressions can be deceiving. Miranda's naivete, Viola's lovesick nature, perfectly imperfect. Wait for the second act. They demonstrated their inner resolve and fortitude way beyond plot devices. Samuel Coleridge noted of Miranda, whose name needs one to be admired, that she had the delicacy of innocence, yet with all the powers of her mind unweakened by the combats of life. Of Viola, though forced to disguise as a man, Shakespeare crafted her as an active character throughout, the catalyst who drives the plot onto its felicitous conclusion. So here I am, hardly facing the survival motif of Miranda and Viola, and yet what I have learned, and most importantly from whom I've learned, those who've helped me write the plot line of my life with my own combats that have been filled with the highest of joyful mountaintops and the darkest valleys of challenge and sadness, is enough to fill a ship captain's manifest journal. Turns out my cast of characters, those who birthed me, urged me, and cheered and chastened me, taught me, mentored me, loved me, is larger, fuller, and more varied than can be found in any of Shakespeare's busiest plays. How about you? You are ultimately the author of your own life. Who's in your cast of characters as supporting actors? Who are your companions in the times of smooth sailing and your ballast in the storms? For me, when asked by those in my ever-evolving and expanding cast of characters, my parents, relatives, teachers, mentors, bosses, colleagues, friends, seeming strangers, when I'm asked to take on what at first seems improbable or even impossible, you know those times when the bubble over your head is silently screaming, what? It is in those very times that I find success and failure and everything in between. When, like Miranda and Viola, I have been thrown overboard or asked to take on something that seems to be over my head, I've learned to swim to shore. I have learned something more about myself in the process. Being wrong, even losing, we gain something in the process of exploration, which always has human fallibility baked into it. Our best bet for creative paths forward? Being perfectly imperfect and trying nevertheless, always. And where better to study this exotic, wonderfully imperfect creature that you are? Right here at Dan Hall. We're even a community of other creatures of perfect imperfections, and where your perfectly imperfect teachers and administrators join you on the journey, defining carefully and creatively what teaching means and what it does. These people are, this school is, just the place to give you the freedom to explore just not just the analytical how questions, but also those exploratory why questions burning inside of you. The springboard to life, the beginning of lifelong learning. Dana Hall and Wellesley College's founder, Mr. Durant, is on record saying this: there's no doubt women can do the work. These schools give them the chance. Folks, it takes a village. And those villages, since the beginning of time, have sprung up with survival specificity, traveling with movable hearts through the wilderness. They've been carved into caves, perched on mountaintops, planted by running water and in fertile soil, have been hidden in the deep underbellies of thick nature, and today roll across these 55 acres framed by Grove Street and memorably, or maybe conveniently named, Dana Road. People in these villages, these communities, have lived in rough-hewn homes, have made livings in bustling marketplaces out of movable pushcarts, and from inside modest storefronts. They've lived on sweeping savannas, on small footprints of land, or in bustling cities. They have moved about in bark canoes and rugged ships, in rickety wagons and motorized cars. They've gone through the dust bowls, the rainbows, through the battlefields, the minefields, and on the playing fields of life. Here we are, itinerant travelers situated right now on the playing fields in zip code 02482, passing through at this very point in time in your life, my life, our lives. Deep tribalism has assured genetic continuity called survival, and brave diasporas have assured that the genetics would both preserve the thread and spread like wildfire in plentiful, welcoming ways. Those who have come before us have joined us in the eternal quest of wondering just what is out there on that vast horizon, a whole new world outside of their and our own imperfectly imperfect selves. Best that you have a sure hand in writing your life story. Take an active role in defining the definition of your script. Be interested in crafting your best possible future, because, folks, the future is where you're going to be spending the rest of your life. In his critically acclaimed novel, Trust, Hernan Diaz wrote, "Whatever the past may have handed us, it is up to each one of us to chisel our present out of the shapeless block of the future." And so to you, O Voyagers, I look over this vast and lovely sea of faces, and I summon up the inspiring words of our aforementioned heroine, Miranda. O brave new world that has such people in it. Thank you.
Thank you.
At the conclusion of the chamber singer's song, it will be time for you to head to your workshops and camps. Our first session starts at 10:15. You can check your packets or the websites for specific locations, either here in the Shipley Center or in other spots around campus. There's a map on the back of your packets, and there are volunteers who are right back there who can direct you if you need help or to guide you to the correct location. Our second session starts at 11:30, and we'll see you all back here at 12:45 for lunch. And now, I am delighted to introduce Dana Hall's Chamber Singers, directed by David Coleman. They will be singing the song near and dear to our hearts, Bridge Over Troubled Water.